Good noon, everyone. I take opportunity to introduce our very special speaker, Mr. Nitin Jhaveri, sir. He is the Director of Concept Business Excellence Private Limited, providing the consultancy services on the business improvement practices. Sir has done his mechanical engineering and master's in the business administration. Sir has also done his diploma in the lean management and in the quality management, total quality management. Sir is certified manager for the quality organization excellence by the ASQ USA. Sir is also certified Six Sigma Master Black Belt. Sir certified as the examiner as the lean auditor for the quality management ISO 9001:2000. Sir has 6 years of industrial experience in the renowned company like ABB, ABC Bearing and Himalaya Machinery. Sir has the experience more than 23 years as the lead consultant. Sir always mesmerized the audience by his power of knowledge. Today he is going to teach us the analyze phase for the three next session. Sir, I would like to request you to please hand over the session.
Thank you, Shruti. And first of all, I am glad that this event has been organized by DDU. And I'm also glad to see so many faculties from all over India participating in this particular subject. I mean, as a consultant since last 23 years, what I have observed is that mostly this subject is of industry people are interested or working executives are interested in this kind of subject. We have also students who are interested in the subject, like we have more than 1,000 students we have trained till now. But this first time I am seeing such a large pool of faculties learning about Lean and Six Sigma. So that's really encouraging. And I thank DDU and I thank Shruti for organizing, Professor Shruti for organizing this event. So without taking much of your time, I would like to just take you through the next phase of analyze. I was locked in just a while ago, so I was also listening to the previous lectures, and I was also glad to see some very interesting questions which were being asked by the audience to the faculty actually. And I am also glad to see Hiren, who was once my student actually for Lean Six Sigma, delivering such a nice lecture actually. So I really congratulate Hiren also for that. Okay, so let me share my screen, and first of all, let us understand how we are, what are we going to discuss in this subject actually today. Okay, so this entire session has been divided into three parts. So the first part is about how do you identify the causes and all those things. So it's a basic concept actually. And then the next phase, which I will take, will be on, we will deep dive into how do we screen the causes, how do we validate the causes. And in the third phase, we'll also see how we can do some advanced analysis for, analysis. So basically, in this first part, we are going to cover these topics. So one is this analyze funnel. We have brainstorming, we have cause and effect diagram, we have this YY analysis, validation of the root causes, and how do we do the GEMBA validation. So these are some topics which we are going to cover in this first part. Now before we move, let me just explain you about the basic concept of entire how do we use this Lean Six Sigma. So you have already you know about the define, and you also know about now measure phase, you also know about some basic statistics. Now entire Six Sigma is is on one equation. This equation we use is called Y is equal to function of X. Okay, now what do we mean by this equation in entire Six Sigma? So in the define phase, maybe Debasis may have covered this concept. So what we do in Six Sigma, okay, so we have two approaches in Six Sigma, which is called DMAIC and DMADV. But let's, in this phase, we are calling about DMAIC. So what do we do in define phase actually? If you have noticed till now, in define phase, what you do is you define why. What is your why? Why is the problem that you are trying to solve? Why is effect? Why is, I would say, dependent? Okay. So this is, we also call this why in Six Sigma language, we call this CTQ, okay, critical to quality parameter. So essentially what we are doing in define phase is we are defining the why. What we do in measure phase, you know, for a while ago, you have gone through this measure phase. Now in measure phase, what are we trying to do? You know, you are trying to see the process is in control or not. You have tried to see whether the process is capable or not. You have tried to measure the baseline of the process. So these are some of the things that you have done through using control chart, using capability analysis and all those things. So what you do is initially you have defined the why, but then you deep dive and measure the current status of the why. Okay. So we in measure phase, we measure why. Again, our focus is why. Okay, that is CTQ. We measure the CTQ. Okay. We measure its, whether it is in control or not. We measure whether the CTQ is capable or not. And what is the current baseline? So we say, okay, my current baseline is this sigma level or that sigma level, or it is this CPK or that CPK, or this is the yield or something like that. What essentially we are focusing on why only. Now, when we go to analyze phase, what are we trying to accomplish? In analyze phase, we are analyzing the X. We are not focusing now on the Y actually. So we analyze the axis. And if you see this X, it is actually, we don't say one X because there can be many X. Usually CTQs are one or two or very few, but the causes which we are trying to, you know, identify. So if we break down this equation is actually is y is equal to, let's say, you know, k1 x1 and k2 x2, plus or minus, we don't know, or k3 x3 like that, okay, and like kn xn. What is this k? This k is a factor, you know, which is impacting the cause. So some, not all the causes, you may have 50 causes in your, which are impacting your problem, but not all the 50 causes are important. Okay, so what do you do? You have to identify the magnitude of the causes. Okay, so what we are doing essentially here is we are trying to understand the impact. So if my k1, which is having you know, more impact, then I find out that particular cause. So our focus in analyze phase is from shifting from Y to X. What we do in improve phase? Can anybody tell me now where is the focus in improve phase? What do you feel? Is the focus X or is the focus Y, or what is the focus?
For X, yeah. Eliminate that X. X factors.
Okay. Yeah, good. Anybody else would like to contribute? What do we do in improve phase out of this? Y or X? What is our focus?
We will be focusing on K to reduce.
Improve Y, sir.
Very good. So what we do in improve phase is, we in improve phase, what we do is we will experiment with X. And not one X, maybe it's few X's, and we will see its impact on Y. So in improve phase, what we do is we identify some solutions. And what we do is we see whether if we change the X, let's say earlier my, let's say my feed rate, if I'm using a machine, if my feed rate was this, now I'm changing the feed rate, okay? Is it going to change my Y, okay? Let's say if my currently my speed is this, if I change my speed, that is my X, if I change my speed, what is going to be the impact on Y? So you do some experiments on X to see its impact on Y. That's what we are doing in improve phase. Now, if you understand this analogy, then I think it's the entire Six Sigma is very easy for you to understand. Okay. Then what we do in control phase? Okay, what we do in control phase? In control, so if you see essentially in analyze phase, we'll see, discuss this, we use a funneling concept. We use a funneling concept where we have, let's say, 50 to 60 causes. And we come down to very critical, based on this K, identifying this K, we come down to these four or six causes, which are where we want to focus. We use a kind of a Pareto principle. You know, we use 80-20 rule. We don't want to work on all the causes because we are smart. We are a Six Sigma person. So we want to use very few causes. That's what we do in analyze phase. In control phase, what we do? In control phase, what we do is once we have seen that this experiment is working in improve phase, what we will do is we will basically, monitor Y and we will control X. We will control the X to such a level so that my Y will be at a new level. Now that's what is the entire Six Sigma concept. So now currently what we are discussing is that we are in this phase where we want to now understand, what are the causes? What is impacting my problem? Now, how do we do this? It's very important to understand and identify the causes. And usually, companies or those individuals who are not practicing Six Sigma, they will say, this is the problem and this is the solution. Six Sigma, we don't do like that. We say, this is the problem. We have to go by all these five phases of Six Sigma. So now, understanding after this, let's go into the details. So what is our aim in analyze phase? What are we trying to accomplish? Okay. So our goal is to identify the root potential root causes. Now, please pay attention to a few words actually. So I'm here saying potential causes initially. Okay, potential root causes. And then I am shortlisting probable root causes. So you see my word is now changing from potential, I'm now saying probable. Okay. And then I will conduct a data analysis and fact analysis. So when I say data, it also means fact. Okay. So what I will do is these causes, I will validate. I will conduct a data analysis. I will validate whether this is the cause or this is not the cause. Okay. Either we'll say yes or we'll say no to each of the causes. So when after data analysis, we will validate the critical root causes, okay? And then once it is validated, then we will that's the end of our analysis phase, okay? And deliverables, what is it that we are going to get out of this? So we'll have list of critical axes. We also have how much problem is accounted by a critical X, So what is the impact? If you see, when we go to the regression analysis and all that, we will have this equation y is equal to function of x. Actually, we will have this equation. So we'll see what is the impact of which x actually, okay, in a particular project. Okay. And then we may have a focused problem statement at the end of this analysis phase. Okay. So that's what we will have. And definitely last, every Six Sigma project, you have to have a toll gate review. So when you pass from one, level to the next level, we have a review and we check whether this activity is completed or not. Okay. So this is how we will go ahead in this analysis phase. So what is the funnel actually? How do we actually understand this? Okay. So how do we kind of, identify the root causes? So this is the funnel that we use. And before that, let me, just show you this or share with you this classic case study which I have experienced. We have been consultants since last 23 years on Lean Six Sigma. We have consulted more than 1,200 companies. This is one company which was manufacturing this kind of springs. Okay, and these springs are being used in the two-wheeler shock absorber. You all must be familiar with this. So this, this is an external part in two-wheeler. So now there are some, this company was located in Gujarat and they were supplying to Endurance, which is manufacturing the shock absorber. And a few things which they have to measure is one is the perpendicularity of the spring. So when you, skip the springs like this, it should be perfectly perpendicular, okay, with respect to the face and height. And there is another requirement also that is about the dimension of this dimension, okay, that is this the overall length of this face. Okay, this is very important. Now we all know that in automobile industries it is very important that they don't do in automobile industries any, they have very less incoming inspection. They only rely on suppliers' quality. They train suppliers, they educate suppliers, and they rely on the supplier. So if the supplier is having any rejection, it will be detected on the line and there will be heavy penalty. So this company provided this spring to Endurance and there was a huge penalty because the entire lot got rejected. And this was almost 2% of the total sales value, their entire turnover. So it was a huge problem for this company. And now this the owner of this company, the CEO of this company, he called a meeting. And he called a meeting to know what is the cause of this issue. Okay. And now, as usual, that what happens in most of the companies, what happens in most of the meetings is that people started discussing about some opinion or some idea about what is the cause. So, for example, the supervisor one, he said, you know, that is the problem is in machine number one. We have various machines. We have a problem in a particular machine. There was another supervisor of production. This is a small scale company. And he said, you know, the problem is in the raw material. Okay, which is supplied by supplier one. Let's say they were using to manufacture this spring, they used to use this coil, steel coils. The coils were coming from China and the choke coils were also coming from Tata Steel. So they say we have problem from the material which is received from China. Then quality head, you know, he said the problem is in our method, our SOPs are not correct. The HR function said the problem is in the shift. You know, maybe the problem occurs in the night shift. Now, you see, I was also present in that meeting and they said, what do you feel? So I was listening to all these opinions and I said, you know, if they are telling anything without any data, without any facts, I can say anything. I can say, for example, that this problem has occurred because of the, government, because of a particular political party which is in rule. And that's why this problem is occurring. Now, so this kind of opinions are important. But these are baseless unless we have data, unless we have facts, okay? So this is just opinion. This is not proving anything, actually. We may have to collect this information, but we cannot rely on this information, okay? So we need a structured brainstorming, very structured brainstorming to understand the causes, actually. So otherwise, what happens in most of the companies is people say, I think it is this, I guess. It is this, and there is intuition, there is, in my opinion, according to me, gut feeling. All these things will be there, but we cannot solve the problems. We cannot identify the root causes based on just gut feeling, intuition, and I think, I feel, I guess. So Dr. Dimick, one of the very famous quality guru, who also said that without data, you are just another person with an opinion. Okay. So what we need is data. If you remember the very famous saying of Dr. Deming, used to say, in God we trust, all others bring data. And which means that if you enter to the Deming's room, and if you say, I think the spring issue is there because of machine, that Deming will come back to you and he will say, do you have data that it is happening because of the machine? Or if somebody says to Deming that I think this problem is occurring in the night shift, Deming will immediately respond, do you have data that this problem is occurring in the night shift? If you don't have any data, you cannot enter my room. If you want to enter my room, you should have either data or you should have either facts. If you don't have data, if you don't have facts, this is just an opinion. I cannot rely on that. So the analysis phase is extremely important to understand this concept, actually, okay? I have seen in many companies people trying to, I mean, experience is important of the people, but if the experience could have worked, you know, we would not be doing the Six Sigma project. The reason why we are doing the Six Sigma project is the problem is not getting solved. And the reason we are doing Six Sigma project is you don't know the causes, because if you know the causes and if it is working, you should not do a Six Sigma project. The very fundamental fact that you are doing a Six Sigma project means that there is a there are causes which you think are there, but you don't know exact answer. So that's why we are going into the details. So what we do is we do this kind of funneling, okay, as I explained you in the beginning. What we do is we follow this funneling process for the causes, or we call it axis. Okay. Now some companies also use this terminology called red X and yellow X or something like that. Okay. So that is also the terminology being used by some companies. Okay, we use a different terminology here, Six Sigma, but that is also one of the, you know, one of the things. So brainstorming for the causes. So first, what we will do is we will have many potential causes. Okay, let's say around 40 to 50, roughly. I'm saying. Okay. We will screen it down. Now I'll tell you how to screen this down to the next level. Okay, we will screen it down, and we will use some technique like multi-voting, C matrix, or something like that, and we will come to probable causes. So please remember the language here. Here we are saying possible causes, and next we are saying probable causes. Okay, now probable causes can be from 40 to 50 to, let's say, around 8 to 10. Okay. And then I put another data analysis and validation. And I do the data analysis and I try to find out the root causes actually. So let's say I have 3 to 6, for example, just as a understanding. Actually. And after validation, we find some causes are validated, some which where we can work, some causes where we cannot work. So we come down to, let's say, 2 to 5 causes. I don't want to work here. I don't want to work on all the causes. That's not a good system. That's not a good scientific approach, actually. The scientific approach is to find out the causes which are having high magnitude, high impact, and to work on those causes. Okay. So in this training, I will tell you how to go from this to this. That's my job to explain to you. And I will also show you a few case studies. We'll also do some analysis on Minitab to understand this entire concept. Now, first thing is, how do we have this 40 to 50 causes? How do we identify this 40 to 50 causes? Okay. So, the one of the most commonly used technique that we use is called brainstorming. Now, you all are maybe familiar with this brainstorming, okay? But here, we use a different approach, actually, okay? Now, usually what happens in brainstorming session is you call all these people who can contribute to these causes, and you start discussing, but the discussion may not have kind of rules or something like that. So what happens usually in the meetings is you see most of the time, I mean, as a practically I have seen as a consultant, most of the time what we see is when you call a meeting for any particular problem, it is not brainstorming. It is actually many times it is blame storming rather than brainstorming. What you do is blame storming means you say this is not my problem, this is somebody else's problem. Okay. Now that way we cannot do the Six Sigma, and we cannot also pinpoint to individual or functions that they are responsible or somebody else is responsible. We need a very structured approach to dig deep into the causes. Okay. So in this brainstorming sessions, what we do is we have to identify as many causes as possible. Now, one thing you have to remember here is that if you see, I have explained you this y is equal to function of x. We have two phases where we do brainstorming. One is the analyze phase, and the other is improve phase. In analyze phase, we do the brainstorming for what? To identify causes. In improve phase also we do brainstorming for what?
Solutions,
okay. Now you see, never mix these two brainstormings. This is a very fundamental advice. I mean, you cannot identify the causes in the same meeting, and you cannot identify solutions also in the same meeting, especially for Six Sigma related projects. I mean, other meetings it is okay, but not for Six Sigma projects actually. So this you have to remember very well. Just a moment, I will. Yeah. So never have these two discussions in one meeting. Okay. We are in analyze phase. We will only discuss about causes. We will not discuss about solutions. The problem is occurring in machine number one. So let us change the machine number one, or let us repair the machine number one. That is not something you have to discuss. You cannot say we want to do some, we want to have some software and the software will solve the problem. That is not something allowed in analyze phase. You cannot discuss solutions in analyze phase. You have to discuss solutions in improve phase. And why we do this is very fundamental, because you have not proven the causes. Once you have to prove the causes, only then you can go to the solutions. Okay, so never mix these two brainstorming sessions. That's one of the first advice actually. So in this brainstorming session, we have many brainstorming methods. For example, the one method which we use is called round robin method, where we sit in the circle and we discuss. The second brainstorming method is also called slip method, where you have people are writing down their ideas on a piece of paper or on a slip, and then you post it somewhere actually, or arrange those ideas. That's called slip method. And there is the third method which we don't use actually, that is called free willing. That is, there are no rules, no regulations. Now if you see, our brain has two parts. So we have logical thinking process and we have creative thinking process. People say we have two parts, the right brain and left brain. Now in analyze phase, what kind of thinking process is required more, logical or creative? Both are required, but which is required more in analyze phase discussion?
Logical.
You need more of a logical. That means, usually we say with the left brain we have more logical thinking. In solutions identification, which process is required more? That is called creative thinking process. Okay. So in your organization also, wherever we go, we have people with different abilities. Each individual is having different ability of logical thinking and creative. It's not that if you have logical thinking, you don't have creative thinking. Some people have both powerful. Somebody has more logical thinking powerful. Somebody has more creative thinking possible. So if you see all the artists and all those people, those who are making music and movies or something like that, they have the creative thinking ability is more. And mostly, engineers, for example, those who are using mathematics and all the same, logical thinking. But there are some people who have both powerful. Now, so we have to do this brainstorming session initially to identify as many ideas as possible. So if you see here, we are saying this reverse now. When you do the brainstorming session, don't limit your number of ideas. Don't limit number of causes actually. So as many causes as possible. We focus on quantity, not quality of ideas initially. So initially in the process of funneling, I don't want to focus on quality. I want as many ideas as possible at this stage. So that's what I want actually, okay? So we will use both the creative and logical thinking ability of the individuals to discuss and to brainstorm. Now we have some simple rules in this round robin method or a simple brainstorming. Nowadays you can also do this online with the available now. So what are the rules that we have to follow? Okay. So first thing is that one person has to act as a facilitator in this discussion. So there will be usually the Six Sigma green belt or a black belt can identify as a can act as a facilitator. Then only one person speaks in this particular meeting. So whenever somebody is speaking, there is in the room there is only one person is speaking at one time. Okay. Usually, if possible, you sit in a circle. You don't sit in a conference room type of arrangements, like this. Don't sit like this. This is not allowed because usually the boss will sit over here or the senior person will sit over here. And most of the people will think that if he's sitting in that position, that's called dominating position. Others have to just listen. That's a psychology. When you are sitting in a circle, there is no dominating position. Okay, in circle there is no dominating position. Everyone is equal. So you want to bring that equality So that's why if you are meeting in person, you have to ensure that you are meeting, you are sitting in a circle. That's one of the rules that you can follow. The next rule you can follow is only cause, no solution. We will not discuss any solution. We will only discuss causes. Why do you think this is occurring? This problem is occurring, okay? Each person will speak in rotation. That means if you are sitting in circle, one person will speak and then the next person sitting to him will speak. You can either go clockwise or you can go anti-clockwise the way you want. But only one person will speak. Only one person will give one idea at a time. Okay. You do not restrict number of ideas. That means you don't say, this may not be possible or that may not be possible or I don't think it is because of the people or I don't think it is because of because of the machine or I don't think it is because of the material. We have tried this in past. Don't use that kind of jargon. Let ideas come because we have a filtration process. So if the ideas are not solid enough, it will automatically get rejected. But initially do not restrict. As I told you, generate as many ideas as possible. Okay, that's what you have to do. When you keep on doing this and when you have no idea, let's say we are rotating this. So once the circle is complete, you can again rotate the circle. And when somebody says, I don't have idea, he or she can say pass. Okay, that's how you will do it. So this should last for at least 30 to 45 minutes. This meeting will, and you will see, because there is no other discussion. We are just discussing. So one person will speak one cause and the facilitator will write down. And the next person will speak the cause and facilitator will write down. And in this meeting, you have to ensure that all those people who are near to the process, they are coming together. Okay. Even if they are not part of your Six Sigma project, you can also bring them. Okay. That is allowed. So you will have at least 30 plus ideas in 30 to 45 minutes. Okay. If you want, you can invite others, as I told you. And the facilitator will, what he or she will do is, he or she will then collate all these ideas. He will put all these ideas in one piece of paper, or you can write it down in PowerPoint, like that. And then we will do some other analysis to filter it down. So I'll tell you that later on. So we can use this concept of multi-voting or FMEA for screening the causes, actually. And then we will create a diagram, which is called cause and effect diagram. So we'll create this kind of diagram and logically arrange the ideas into cause and effect diagram. Okay. Now, after the cause and effect diagram, we will further go in deep and we will do the why analysis of the selected causes. Okay, after funneling or after multi-voting, we will do the why analysis. So this is the process that we will follow, actually. Okay. So let me show you one, simultaneously one small case study. This is one of the case study which I would like to share with you so that you have feel of how to do these projects. So this is not an engineering company but a chemical company, but I think it will be easy for you to understand this. So this company was manufacturing material which is used for filling purposes, like in toys and mattresses and jackets. You have this material. And their project title was to reduce a raw material consumption, because they were using one particular raw material. So I'm not deliberately disclosing the name, but that raw material was used in the final product. The final product name is PFF. And to manufacture this material, there are a lot of raw material. The material consumption is eradicated and it is sometimes high, sometimes low, like that. Now, let me explain you the case. This is the bottles which we throw, actually. What this company is doing is they collect these bottles and they crush it, actually. And after crushing it, what they do is they purify it, actually. And it undergoes through some process, because this is dirty and it is having a lot of impurities. So they process it. And after processing, this becomes like fiber filled, actually. So this fiber filled is the final product. Okay, this is called PFF. This product is called PFF, polymer fiber fill, polyester fiber fill. So this PFF product actually If you want to clean this, you need some raw materials, different kind of raw materials. And that consumption was very high. One of the raw material consumption was very high. Now, this is the final application of this particular raw material. But this is the case. Now, this company has, I'll just show you right from the defined phase. I will take you up to analyze phase. Okay. And if you are interested, if you have time, we'll also take other phases also. But this is very easy for you to understand. So the this particular raw material, which is called SF, the consumption is currently, you know, it should be 12 kg as per their study, because other companies, when they are using this process, they are using 12 kg per metric ton of the final product. And here in this plant, they are using more. The total conversion cost of this material is 27%. Okay. So this is a highly costliest material. And if they reduce 1 kg per metric ton, there is a huge benefit. Okay, I would deliberately remove the conversion cost. And there are also customer complaints related to ununiform product feel. So the customers are feeling a lot of variation in the product feel. And this is related to the uniform. So this is why they have selected. So this, if you know, in the Six Sigma green, this defined phase, we call this business case. So there are two objectives. On the one side, we have organization goal. On the other side, we have also customer delight. So both the things we want to address. That's why we have selected this project. Now, this is some, just a simple project charter, where, I mean, not the complete project charter, but the sample of that actually. So if you see here, we have the title, project title, reduction of this particular raw material for this particular product. Current consumption is 14 kg. This is the current consumption. They want to reduce it up to 12 kg per metric ton. The critical to quality parameter which they want to focus is this raw material consumption in kg per metric ton. This is the same business case which we saw earlier. This is a baseline measurement. So they have collected data for a few months and they have calculated the baseline. Okay. This is the annualized saving, if possible. What is the annualized saving possible? They have mentioned the process which they want to focus. This is the start date. This is the end date of this project. Then they have created this SIPOC map, which you may have seen in the defined phase. Why I'm showing you this, all these other phases, is you can understand how they have applied the brainstorming and all those stuff actually. Okay. So this is this SIPOC map, supplier input, process output, and customer. So this is the process. These are the step of the process 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Very briefly, these steps they have highlighted because they want to focus on these steps actually. This is the area where they want to improve. They want to scope the project, Six Sigma project. And for this process, they need input like flex, they need steam, they need power. These are all the inputs needed. They need this raw material, which is called SF. They need this another raw material, which is called textile finish. They also need this production program. The flex are received from store. Utilities is providing them the steam and power. Vendor is providing them these two material. Marketing is supplying them this production program. What is the output of this? The output is, one is PFF, which is the final product. And there is this waste. There is this condensate. And there is this effluent. This is coming out of the process. What is, where the PFF goes? It goes to the warehouse. Where the waste goes? It goes to the store. Where the condensate goes? It goes to the utility. And where the effluent goes? It goes to the ET plant. So this is the complete CPOC map. And then they have also created a detailed process flow diagram. Okay. So this is how they have just created a detailed process flow diagram to explain and to understand in defined phase. They have also created a schematic diagram, because in the Six Sigma team, if there are many people, for them to understand, they have created this kind of schematic diagram. I deliberately put it in blur mode because I don't want to disclose the information. Okay. Now this is the CTQ table. Okay, if you see the CTQ table, they say our what is the problem to reduce the silicon finish consumption. CTQ is silicon finish consumption in kg per metric ton. The same thing over here, this is called CTQ. What is the operational definition? So very clearly, we have identified the silicon finish oil used per day in kg divided by packed production per day in kg. You very clearly identify how we measure the CTK. Very clear, no ambiguity. And then what is the defect definition? So you say defect definition is our target is 12. So if any day our consumption is more than 12, we will consider this as a defect. What is the Kano status? It is must be, because you know, this is related to high cost. Because of this, the cost is increasing, and also the customer is unhappy, dissatisfied. So that's why it's a basic thing that the customer wants, you know. So that's why it is called must be the Kano status. Now, coming back to this measure phase in this company, what they have done is they have created a data collection plan. In this data collection plan, you can see I'm not complete data collection plan, just part of it. So what to measure, they have mentioned, okay, how it will be measured, what kind of data will be collected, whether it is continuous or discrete or whatever it is, what is the target, what is the period for which I want to collect data, from which location I will collect the data, and what are the related conditions to be observed. So this is just one row, there will be many rows like this. This company has decided that we will not do any gauge R&R study, that means the measurement system evaluation. So they say because every day they use a weighing balance to measure this, and the weighing balance is calibrated on a daily basis. So the data is already accurate, so we cannot we can consider the data as reliable. Okay, so they don't need to conduct any other measurement related analysis. Okay, this part. Now coming back to their baseline performance. Okay, so this is the baseline performance. So if you see, they have collected this data. This is the control chart. Can you identify which control chart is this?
X bar R chart.
Okay. Anybody else?
Sorry, IMR chart. Sorry.
Yeah, correct. So this is IMR chart. You can see here it is written individual and moving range, because X bar R chart we use when we have subgroup. Here we don't have subgroup. They collect the data on daily basis. There is no kind of subgrouping not done that data. So this is the IMR chart. Out of this IMR, they have only shown here I chart, not MR chart. That's okay. And you can see what is the baseline here. Now baseline is 14.14. That is current line, current baseline. Now they want to check whether this data follows normal distribution or not, because as you know, you were discussing in the measure phase, there are many distributions in statistics, but we usually assume that the data is following normal distribution. So how do we you know, check this? So in Minitab there is a provision, and there are other statistical softwares well where also there is a provision. So you know, you create this kind of normality check, and you can find out whether the data is following normal distribution. So here it says the probability value. What is the probability value that the data is normal? Okay, so this is 0.06. So if it is, in this case, when it is more than 0.06, that means we say data is not non-normal, the data is normal. What is the data is following normal distribution? So that is also checked. And they have checked the capability. Just now you were discussing in the measure phase about the capability. So capability can be calculated in different ways. Okay, so here they have calculated. Now if you see here, their requirement is 12. So this is 12, and most of the time their readings are coming on this side. Okay, ideally what they want is less than 12, that means on this side. Okay, but currently if you see all the readings they have taken, here also you can make out in this chart also, most of the readings are more than 13. Okay, this is the value. So there is no value which is less than 12. So that's why they are saying that the sigma rating is less than 0. Okay, negative. Okay. They have also calculated capability in another format, that is called CPK. Okay, so this is in minus. Why it is minus? Because your mean is already shifted. Then we have this PPM, or you know, I was saying DPMO, but here in Minitab they call it PPM. How many parts per million can be detected? And of course, it's a less than 6 sigma, so 1 million. So we'll not give exact 1 million because it's a probability. It's saying 999,999. What is the current mean? Current mean is this value, okay, which has come from this control chart. So this is my current performance. I can say this is my performance now. I want to improve this performance. Okay. Okay. So now, if you see here, the same thing which I was talking to you. Now I will just show you that also. So we use. So just keep this this up to this portion. Just keep this in mind. This case study. I will show you this how they have done gone for the analyze phase in detail in this particular project. Okay. So what we do is we have in analyze phase we have this brainstorming. We then I'll collect all the ideas and we put this in a diagram called cause and effect diagram. So this has three names. So first name is called cause and effect diagram. The second name is called Ishikawa diagram because it was introduced by Japanese quality guru Dr. Ishikawa, and it is also called fishbone. Why it is called fishbone? Because it looks like a fishbone. So there are three names to it. You call it CE diagram, you call it Ishikawa diagram, you call it fishbone diagram, is all the same. Okay. So this diagram looks like this. If you see this here, we can what we do is after brainstorming, whatever the causes we have gathered, we will group them. We will group them into some categories. Can you tell me what are the natural categories in any cause and effect diagram? If anybody is familiar with this, what are the normal natural categories of any cause? Main categories.
5M plus 1E.
Yeah, 5M. That is man,
machine, material,
method, material, and measurement.
Measurement.
Okay, sometime we also add mother nature also.
Energy is one of other.
And mother nature is some environmental factors or something like that. Okay, so usually we have this kind of category, but not necessarily you will have to have this 5M or 6M or something like that. You can create your own categories. Okay, you can have your own grouping. So in this case, for example, my petrol consumption is high. What is the cause? So we have vehicle as a cause, we have driver as a cause, we have procedure as a cause, we have road as a cause, we have maintenance as a cause, major category, and then we have material also as a cause. Yeah. Okay. So now we have what we have done here is we have arranged all this into causes and sub causes and sub causes. Okay, so in vehicle what can be issues? So it's a technical details. So what is the technical details? A carburetor. Okay, within the carburetor we say what is the issue? Let's say the fuel mix, for example. Spark plug is the issue. Spark plug. What can be the issue? The life of the spark plug, for example. So like that we have arranged. After brainstorming all the data into this kind of logical scenario. So now let us see what they have done in that particular chemical company. What they have done. They have also done the same thing. They have arranged the data in a very logical format. So this is the problem, which is called effect. Okay. And they have created four categories here. One is called machine. The second is called product field. The third is called finish application. And the fourth is called man. It was comfortable for them to have these four categories. It's okay. Now what they have done is they have arranged all this data, all this after brainstorming, that 30-40 minutes brainstorming session which they did, they have arranged all this data in this format actually. Okay, so this is the next step. Okay, just keep this in mind. I'll take you this case study simultaneously as I explain you the theoretical concept. Okay, because sometimes only theory will be difficult to understand. Okay.
Can we request you to please hide that ribbon?
Yeah,
which is appearing on the screen.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Now, sorry. Now I have so many causes. How do I go ahead? I need to screen them. I cannot work on all the causes. Okay. So what do I do? I need to screen the causes. How do I screen the causes? There are a few methods. There are other methods also, but few methods which I suggest. So first method which I suggest is called, for example, multi-voting. So what we do in multi-voting is you can ask all your employees. You can just print this list of causes and you can ask everybody in that meeting to give a vote to this particular list. So you have 30-40 causes, print it and give it to everybody, and you say out of this, let's say 50-60 causes, select only 5. Okay, and then the next, each person in your team, so you have many people in your team and we have all these causes 1 to 50. Okay, let's say the first person has selected this cause, the next person has selected this cause, but the first cause is also selected by another person. So we just put a simple tally mark like this, and we will identify which cause is having highest selected by high maximum number of people based on this. So this is called simple multi-voting. So out of all these 50 causes, I will then select off 7 or 8 causes actually. So that's one method actually, okay, to screen down. Okay, so remember, all these 30-40 causes are called potential causes. Once you do a multi-voting, we will call it a probable causes. Okay, so this is how the other technique which you can use is also called FMEA. You can use FMEA to screen down the causes. FMEA stands for failure mode effect analysis. It's a very simple technique to give a rating to each of these causes. Okay, and this is kind of a risk analysis, and you can identify which are the causes we need to focus for. So if you see in this company, they have immediately after that they have created an FMEA. Okay, so I'll show you that later on actually. So that is this FMEA. And then you can also do GEMBA. GEMBA means you go to the place and verify yourselves. You know, many times you get to know the information not by collecting the data, but by collecting the facts. Okay, so you can go to the place wherever it is possible. You can go to the place and verify some claims. Okay, let's say it is in this company only. In this case study which I am showing you, the material consumption is high. Somebody said material consumption is high because we issue the material in drum and people are not using the complete drum. They keep some leftover material in the drum and throw the drum in scrap. How do you verify this? You go to the scrapyard and see the empty drums and see whether any leftover material is there or not. As simple as that. Okay, so that's called GEMBA. Then screening the preliminary causes with data. Sometimes before we, sometimes we already have a past data available. Before going ahead in, in the screening down, I can just do some preliminary data analysis, like we use this box plot or some bar chart or Pareto chart or something like that, and just preliminary do the screening to screen down the causes. So what happens is, I have now 30 to 40 causes. Okay, and now I'm screening it down to 10 to 15 causes. Okay, or less than that also sometimes. Now if you see, now let us see this. So you see here also I have just highlighted how do we screen it down. So let's see this in the case study. In this case study, now you can see here what is happening is some causes are highlighted with red color. You can see the 6 causes are highlighted with red color. How did they identify these 6? They used a technique which is called FMEA. This is the FMEA. I will explain you FMEA later on, but they have applied this technique. And wherever the rating was high, this RPN number is high, they have identified those as a causes. That we will first work on this high rating causes, actually high probable causes. Okay, so this is one technique which they have applied, and you can see now here that how they have come down from, and all these 30-40 causes, which you can see other causes also, these are called potential causes, and the red ones are called probable causes. Okay, so this may be 30 to 40, this may be 5 to 6 or 5 to 10, something like that. Here it is 6 they have identified in this case. Okay, now we can also do further, we can also use something called YY analysis. Okay, now what is YY analysis? Very simple. I have been trained in Japan. I was lucky enough to visit Japan and learn from Japanese industries. So I have visited many Japanese companies, and I have seen this one thing which is very common in them, is that whenever there is a problem, they will not ask who has done this. They will always ask why. Okay. So if you see, I usually say this, in Japanese they do why analysis. In other countries, you know, even some companies I visited in India also, they don't do why analysis, they do who analysis. So who analysis means the first question you ask is kisne kiya, who has done this, who was present at that time, which operator, which supervisor, which manager was present then, what was he doing. You know, these are some of the common things that we do. Now we have to ask why, and what they say is, if you ask several times why, maybe fifth why, you may not have to go sometime to fifth why also, but on an average to fifth why you will get the root causes. So let's say this is one example, and how do we do the countermeasures? Okay, so let's say there is oil on the floor. So for the countermeasure is, you clean the oil. Okay, why is the oil on the floor? Because the machine is leaking the oil. Okay. What is your countermeasure? You say, okay, fix the machine. Then we have, because the gasket was leaking. Why the machine is leaking the oil? Because the gasket was deteriorated. Okay, the countermeasure is to replace the gasket. But why the gasket was deteriorated? Because we bought the gasket of inferior material. The quality of the gasket was not good. So, okay, change the specification. But why did we purchase inferior quality of gasket? Because of we got a good deal on the price of the gasket. The purchaser manager got a good deal on the pricing. So, okay, what is the countermeasure? You change the purchasing policies. Okay. And why is that? Because the purchase manager is evaluated, his KRA, key result area, his performance evaluation is done based on how much saving he is bringing. Okay, you also change the evaluation policy. So now you can imagine how we can go into the details, and up to fifth why usually you will get if you don't do this in a proper way. Okay, sometimes we go in a wrong direction, then you will not get correct answers. Okay. So we can also do this. I'll also show you how this was done in that particular case study. Okay, so let's see what people make mistake in this why analysis. Why analysis looks very simple, but people make a lot of mistake in that, because we don't identify actionable root causes. So for example, we say, what is the problem? Let's say this is a restaurant, and say there is a bread on the table is having mold. So mold is some kind of bacteria kind of a thing, fungus kind of a thing. Okay, and what is the solution? You throw the bread and get a new loaf. Okay, that's the solution. But if we do proper why analysis, what can happen actually? Okay, so you say the bread on the table is moldy. Go and get the new piece. Okay. Now you see, this is here we are saying why analysis. Why? Because waiter did not see the mold. Why? Because of the poor training or old glasses that he was wearing. Poor lighting. This, if you see in this direction, this is not giving us some actionable ideas. These are not actionable. Poor training is not very vague actually. Old glasses. This is also, you know, kind of vague actually. Okay. So what is the correct method of doing why analysis? Poor lighting. This is very common, very easy. You know, you say, worker did not see the mold, but that is not the correct, this itself is not correct. Why was the mold there? Not because the worker did not see, but why the mold was there in the first place? That is where you have to start. So if you do wrong why analysis, you will end up with a wrong conclusion. So this is one of the better answer, I would say. Say, why the bread on the table is having mold? Because the mold had the loaf had a mold. Okay, the bread was having because the loaf was having. Why the loaf was having? Because it was already expired. The material date of its expiry date was already over, and we used it. But why the date expired actually? because we get the bread in this hotel, you know, it is delivered within one day of the freshness, and then it comes the next 2 days after, the next loaf comes after next 2 days. Why is that happening? Because the contract requires delivery of fresh bread. But in the contract, they have not mentioned what is the meaning of freshness. Okay. So this is somewhat better YY analysis than just saying that the operator or worker did not see the mold actually. You know, then you go in a wrong direction actually. So you have to keep this in mind when you are doing this kind of YY analysis. So let's go to that case study again, and I'll tell you to the YY analysis how they have done. So they have problem of high material consumption, and there are 6 causes they have identified as a probable causes. So this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, the next slide it is 4, 5, and 6. So they have created a tree diagram instead of a simple YY. You can also create this kind of tree diagram, because sometimes your one Y may have multiple answers. Okay, so they say finish flow variation. So why is the finish flow variation? Poor finish control. Why? Because of the pump design. Why? Because it is a centrifugal pump with a poor control on the discharge. Okay, now let's see some other example. So this example, leftover finish in the drum, this was identified as a cause. Why? Because of the drum design. Why? Because the drum outlet is small. Okay, idle running of the finish pump. The pump is running when it is idle actually. Why? The pump is not getting stopped. Why is it that? Because there is no interlocking mechanism on the pump with the line. Whenever the line is not required, the pump is not automatically stopping. That's the issue. This is how you go into doing the YY analysis further once you do the you know, the brainstorming, and once you identify the probable causes. Okay, but this is not all. We have to still validate the causes, so I will also take you to that actually. Okay, okay, so up to this time phase, any question, anything, any input or any question you have? Are you clear on what I'm explaining to you?
Sir, I have one question. In slide number 31, sir, with the help of FMEA, what basis we are screening that probable causes, sir? Based on RPN or here in the based on RPN?
Based on RPN, yes. I will also explain you the example of our FMEA.
Okay.
So in FMEA, we calculate this risk priority number. Okay. So based on the risk priority number, I can just select the causes which are having high RPN. So,
Okay, thank you.
And that is in engineering companies, it is very useful actually, because most of the engineering companies say you cannot just do simple YY analysis. You have to have some solid basis on that. So FMEA is a very good tool to screen the causes actually in that case.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So I need some enlightenment to how to implement this same in the service industry as well.
Like, service industries.
Like IT. Can we I'm getting conceptual backgrounds how it is implementing in the manufacturing units. How we can implement it in IT IDS?
Which
particulars we need to take care of?
I will show you the case study, because that will be easy for you to understand. So what I will do is, I will also show you the case study on this IT IDS company. Actually, what is the good name actually?
My name is Sachin Chaturvedi, sir.
Okay. Sure, I will show you the case study on IT also. Okay, how IT companies or BPO companies, for example, they can use the Six Sigma approach. I have a case study. So I will also show you that. Okay. Let me just finish this, and I will remind me if then, I forget this.
I'm getting a new thing, but I need to understand in that way.
Yeah, it's very important, because we have worked with both service industries and manufacturing. So I'll cover that like example also. We have some case study on ITES companies. So I'll show you that actually.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other question? Okay, so let's go ahead now. We have now come to probable causes. Okay, now what is required is we have to now validate or verify and validate the causes. And here I strongly believe in this. Your probable causes or potential causes is not the root cause. Is not the root cause until it is validated. So when you say it is root cause, you should have evidence, you should have proof. Okay, you cannot just say that this is the cause and that is the cause, okay, based on just brainstorming, based on just YY analysis. That's something not I would say encouraged in Six Sigma kind of projects. What we need is a very clear cut analysis and very clear cut validation, okay, for the causes. Now, how can you validate the causes? So if you see your Minitab actually, so your Minitab on the right side, you have this assistant button, the latest version of Minitab. And you see there is all this entire menu is given to you, which gives you already, this is not my slide actually, this is given from Minitab. They already have given you ideas on how you can perform different kind of analysis. So first is we can perform some kind of graphical analysis, as it was being discussed in the measure phase actually. So you can use let's say if I want to see the distribution of the data, if I want to see the distribution of the data, I can use graphical summary in the Minitab. I can use Pareto chart in Minitab. I can use histogram. I can also see bar chart, but that is basically categorical data, pie chart, which was already explained to you in measure phase. You can also use this box plot. You can also use this individual value plot. These are some of the graphical data. So this will also help you to understand about the causes. Okay, so you can also understand the causes. Sometime we can also use control chart in analysis phase. So I want to see variation. I want to see whether the process is in control or not. So I can also use control chart. So if I want to see the over a period of time, then these are charts which I can use. I want to see the relationships, okay, of the two variables, okay. So I can use scatter plot, which we were just discussing. You can also use scatter plot with groups. Then there is called matrix plot, where we have multiple, scatter plots and you want to see. Then you also have in Minitab, there is a provision called scatter plot matrix with a group. You can also have groups. Then you have something called main effect plot. Then you have something called interaction plot, okay? And then you have something called multivariate chart. So this is also very useful. So these are some of the ways, you can also validate the causes by doing some kind of graphical analysis, okay? So let us see, we'll see that also. What is other thing possible to analyze the causes? Now we want to prove. If I say it is because of machine one, I have to prove it is because of machine one. If I say it is because of, let's say, night shift, I have to prove that it is because of night shift, okay? And that I can prove this by graphical analysis and some other statistical analysis. So other statistical analysis is called hypothesis testing. So I can do some kind of hypothesis testing. So all those people who are PhD in this, they have, I think, used this hypothesis testing for their, this thing actually. So we can use this hypothesis testing actually, and I will explain you this in detail, hypothesis testing, where we can compare one sample with the target, we can compare two samples, we can compare more than two samples, and there are different techniques, like t-test and one sample standard deviation, and then percentage defective, chi-square test. So there are a lot of hypothesis testing is possible actually. Okay, so this is how we will screen the causes. Okay, so Now you may have a question. If I want to prove this point, I want to say, is it because of machine? Is it because of material? Is it because of shift? How do I prove this? So I can collect some sample data. Okay. I can look at the historical data if available. Okay. I can go to the workplace and make some kind of observations. And I can also collect some voice of customers. So I can go to the customers and I can understand from the customers what is their voice actually. Okay. And we can then create some equation also, y is equal to function of x if appropriate, if possible actually. Okay. Okay, so gamma is a very important concept to validate. So we have, I always say this, you have to use both data and facts. Data you will get from numbers, from reports, from software, you will get this data, which you can put in graph. But every time data itself will not give you all the details. You also have to go to the reality. You have to go to the place where things are happening and check the facts. That's called your gamma observation. Okay. So always rely on data as well as facts. You see this. I mean, this is both are, you know, in Japanese companies, they do a lot of fact verification. So they go to the gamba and they verify, you know, the people are going to the shop floor and then verifying what is happening. Most of the Western companies, they use this, you know, they rely on conference room and meetings and data and all that. But Japanese people believe in going to the place and verifying. But in Six Sigma project, we recommend to both. We recommend data, we recommend facts also. So this is one classic case study which I would like to just share with all of you. I was working with a company and this company was supplying parts to some company. And they used to have this spot welding process. So what they have to do is they have to spot weld the nuts like this, you know, and this is used in some by their customers. This is being used. Now, when they were doing this spot welding, and they have some customer complaints and we are all discussing these causes, but then what are the root causes, and we were all discussing about various root causes. So what happens, you know, in this spot welding, there used to be some, the thread used to get distorted and then the other part is not fitting into it, so they have some kind of spatters in the spot welding process. Now, ideally, in the spot welding process, there should not be any spatters. Okay, in arc welding, you may have spatters, but in spot welding, you should not have it should not happen actually. So, what we did is, we said, let us go to the place and verify. So, you all know that, if you are engineering people, you must know that the spot welding process is like this, as shown in the figure. So, what we checked was, first of all, we asked the operator, why is this spatter coming actually? Then our operator, he said, sir, we have SOP. And we said, okay, please show us how you follow this SOP. And what we came to know was that, there is the temperature which the operator has to set. There is the dwell time which the operator has to set. There is this pressure which the operator has to set. And he said, sir, I don't have this meter, which is for the pressure, is not working actually. When we observed that, we came to know that he was not observing the pressure. We said, why are you not observing the pressure? He said, the pressure gauge is not working. So how do you set then? He said, I just set based on my experience actually. So now, because the gauge is not working, he's not able to set the pressure correctly. So what happens is, when you go to the gemba, when you go to the place where things are happening, when you actually observe the process, you will get reality. That is also very important to identify the root causes. Okay. So, let me just very quickly take you through this FMEA concept now. How do we use this? So, FMEA stands for failure mode effect analysis. Okay, this also we can use in analyze phase. Okay. So, we have the failure mode, how a particular thing can fail. Okay, we have the causes. So, we have failure modes, we have the causes, and we have the effect of the causes. These are the first three things that we want to know in a FMEA sheet, FMEA model actually. Okay. So for example, failure can be anything. Why is my raw material consumption high? What is the cause? What is the ultimate effect? Okay. So like that. Okay. So this is a standard template of FMEA. This is a universal template. You can also download this from internet if you want. Okay. This is a standard template. So this is the first, we will have a process step. Then we will have here failure mode. If this is the process step, how can it fail? So we'll have process failure mode. Then we have the effect. If this fails, what is the impact? So we write down the effect. And then we have three columns, which are very important. One is called severity, one is called occurrence, and the third is called detection. It's shown with this thing. The severity we write down in 1 to 10. Occurrence we write down in 1 to 10. Detection we write down in 1 to 10. So what is severity? Severity is how deadly is this effect? How dangerous it is? How, you know, risky it is? So we give this rating. Then we write down the potential causes. What are the probable causes for this to happen? And how likely that cause can occur? How likely is it possible that that cause will occur? So what is the frequency, probability of occurrence? If it is a very high probability of occurrence, I will give a 10 rating. If it is a very less probability of occurrence, I'll only give 1 rating. And then I have this control mechanism. So if, what is the currently, how are we controlling this? So we'll put again here 1 to 10 scale. So for example, can I detect? So this is the detection rating here based on the control mechanism. Can I detect the failure immediately? Or I will be able to detect this only after it reaches to the customer. So what I will do is I will multiply this severity and occurrence and detection, and I will get a rating here. And that rating, as one gentleman was mentioning, is called RPN. It is called risk priority number. And this risk priority number is severity into occurrence into detection. Without going into theory, let me take you through this case study now. So you see here, this is the FMEA, what they have done. I'm only showing you FMEA for the shortlisted causes now. They have done this for many, but I'm only showing you for the shortlisted causes. So they say, what is the potential failure mode? You know, for example, finish flow variation. What is the effect? The uniform high consumption and non-uniform finish application. This is the effect. How severe it is with respect to our project. So they have given out of 1 to 10, they have given 9. This has to be done in a team. And all the team member has to agree to this rating. If you have disagreement, you have to discuss. And you have to come to a common consensus. Okay, this cannot be done by one individual person. What is the potential cause? This is a poor flow control system. How frequently is it occurring? They say out of 1 to 10, they say it is 6. What is the current mechanism to control this thing, this cause? They say we have SOP to take the reading of the flow meter. And what is the detection ability? Okay, is it good or is it poor? So here they are saying that the detection ability is currently, it's a 4 actually. Okay, so we have in detection, if I cannot detect, I will put 10. But if I can detect, I will put less numbers. So here they say it's moderately, it's okay. That is not an issue. Detection is not an issue. So 9 into 6 into 4 is this 260, 216. What they have done, they have listed down all these causes. For all these causes, they have done the FMEA. And after doing the FMEA, they have come down to these high risk priority numbers. So there are this particular case, what they have said is all the causes where the RPN is more than 10, we will consider that for validation. You can see here, these 6 causes are identified after this FMEA. Okay. So like this, it is everywhere it is there. So for example, idle running of the pump. Why? What is the effect? The effect is this. What is the severity? This. Why? What is the cause? The pump is not stopping. What is the occurrence? Pump is not stopping. 6. What is the current mechanism to check this? They say we do the audit. How effective is the audit? So what is the detection mechanism? So they have put this. Okay. So and then they have this final RPN number. Okay. Now comes the most important part of this FMEA. After doing this FMEA, so I'll show you one case study, last case study of another case study of FMEA. So FMEA can be used for design as well as for process. So in Six Sigma, usually we are working to improve the process. We use process FMEA, but it can, if you are doing a design for Six Sigma project, DFSS project, you can also do that DFMEA also, design failure mode effect analysis. A process FMEA is called PFMEA. So I have, for example, this cable car. Okay. So this cable car ride, and now this is example of design failure mode effect analysis. What is the potential failure mode? You say cable can break. What is the impact? What is the effect if cable breaks? If cable breaks, customer either dies or there will be a severe injury to the customer. How severe is it? Is it severity is obviously 10. So we have 10. It's very high risk actually. What is the current what is the cause for this? So they say, for example, just as a, you put aircraft collision with the tower of the ropeway. What is the other reason possible? So you say corrosion in the cable. What is the other reason? We say maximum strength can exceed. Okay. Now, how likely that the aircraft will collide with the tower? The occurrence is very less because this has never happened actually. So they say, okay, very less chances that it will happen. Corrosion, what is the chance that the cable will have corrosion? Very high chances. They say 10. Very likely that it can occur. What is it like? How likely it is that the strength will exceed? They say only 1. Why? Because they have already some mechanism. What is that mechanism? They have already provided some safety factors and they have also provided the load center sensors in the cabin. Okay. So in the past, it has not happened that the strength has exceeded. Now, what is the current process control? So we have on the tower, we have these lights, beacon lights, which can give the indication to the aircraft. And how easily can we detect if the aircraft collides? So, of course, detectability is very less because we will come to know only when it collides, the collision happens. We have, in order to remove the take care of corrosion, we have currently a coating. How can we check whether the corrosion has occurred or not? So, its rating is given as 5. Whether the strength will exceed, how likely we will come to know? You say very easily because. So this is easy, this is moderate, this is difficult. So they like this, they have given the rating. Now if you see here, we have given the RPN. This is 100, this is 500, and this is 10. Okay. So based on this, I can prioritize where do I need to focus. Okay, because my severity is also high, my occurrence is also high, my detectability is also poor. So I need to focus on that. So the next step of FMEA is this. We have put what actions are required. Here say none. Here also there is no action. What is the action here? They say we'll put a corrosion sensor, which are available now nowadays. So, and in this is who will do this? So person so and so. What is the action taken? So completed and validated. And after completing this action, again you will write down the severity. Again you will write down the occurrence. And again you will write down the detectability. Usually, severity will not change because if cable car breaks, the severity is going to be the same. But occurrence can reduce because of our action. Detection can reduce because of our action. Okay. Sometimes even severity can also reduce. If you provide some safety net below this thing, then it can also reduce the severity. So now my revised RPN number is 60. Okay. So this is the example of this. So the same thing is applied in this particular case also. This company has also done the same thing. Okay, so just I will show you this remaining portion now in that case study later on. Now, any question on this? You have any question on this?
Sir, I think no question. We can move
no ahead. Question. Okay. So let me just quickly show some case study, if possible, on that very quickly. One small case study on this ITS companies. So I'll just share one small case study on ITS companies, very simple case study. So you can correlate how the Six Sigma is applying to ITS kind of environment. So is the screen visible now?
Yes, sir, visible, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So now you see here, this is a BPO company where we have IT BPO company or service industry. And they want to see the impact on the call time. Impact on the call time. And there are the variables what they have identified is one is shift. One is the script being used for calling the people. And the amount of, material they have to sell. This is like a credit card selling or some kind of company. So like this, there are some factors actually, okay. So now we want to find out which are the causes and how this can be applied, this root cause analysis can be applied. Okay. So we have this basic data, we have operator, we have shift, we have script, and we have cells, and we have the time data. And this is what our output variable is. This is what our CTQ is. We want to improve this actually. And now we want to see what is impacting person, shift, script, cells. So we have collected some data, basic data, okay, like this, okay. And I'll not take you through all the details, but just very quickly. So we have first of all plotted the control chart of the time, and this is how the control chart looks for the time, okay, for several data points. So there are some few outliers, for some few special causes, but most of the time it is on the same. This is 25 minutes is what they take, and they have created now this is a this company, they were all learning, so they have created a lot of charts actually. So they have created time on histogram on time, they have created histogram on script, but it doesn't make any sense, you should not do that actually. And on cells also they have created the histogram just to see how it looks actually. Okay, they have checked the shape, they have checked the normality of the data, whether the data is normal or not, time data is normal or not. Okay. So this is the normal data because my p-value is more than 0.05. And they have collected, done some other analysis. I'll just I've not taught you all these graphs and charts, but this is something which I was just mentioning in Minitab as a main effect plot. This main effect plot is basically will tell you who is contributing what. So this is on Y scale, we have time, and here you have operator, and this is the mean value, okay? And this is shift. So the Bob is mean value is this, Jan mean value is this, Walt mean value is this. Similarly, here it is the shift, okay? And this is the script. So they are using 5 different scripts. So this is how the time is varying according to the script. Now they have done box plot also. So they have done box plot on script, box plot on shift, box plot on operator. I hope you will be able to understand also where is the cause now. Okay. So just by doing this kind of simple analysis. Okay. Then they have done this kind of multivariate chart. So in this multivariate chart, what they have done is morning and evening shift. So this is having now three-way chart actually. So this is, you have script also, you have time also, you have shift also, you have everything is input in an operator also. Everything is put in one chart. So this is script number, each panel is script. So this is script 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This mean line is for script variation. Okay, this green one. This is for the operators. Say this is in script 1, in morning shift, operator 1 or 2 or 3, whatever it is actually. Okay. So this is how this chart is created now. So I hope you will be able to understand from this chart where is the more time going actually. So if you see most of the time, the PM shift, there is more time is going, or average is high. So here also, if you see, irrespective of the operator, the PM shift is contributing more actually, usually. Okay. That's a PM shift, so evening shift. Okay. Now they have also done some other charts. Okay, I'll not go into these details. They have checked something called ANOVA. These are all statistical analysis to see the variation in morning shift versus evening shift. So there is a statistically very high significance. And there is operator wise. This is Bob, this is Jen, this is Walt. They have provided, done this ANOVA. So Bob and Jen, there is less variation. But if you compare them with this particular person, Walt, then he is having very high average time actually. They have created the scatter plot also to see whether the cells and the time is related with each other or not. And there is no correlation formed actually, because the line is straight. So ideally, if my line is like this, I will say positive correlation. If my line is like this, I'll say negative correlation. But here the line is straight, so there is no correlation. By looking at this chart now, all these graphs, if we see, we have to focus, where do we focus on the causes? Which are the causes you are coming out apparently? And anybody can answer me this? By looking at those graphs, what do you understand? Which were the probable areas where we need to focus?
Shift.
One was shift, that is PM.
Operator.
And operator. So that fault. So these two things we have to now focus on, okay? And we can do further analysis also. Why Walt takes more time? We can do IVA analysis on that. Why in PM shift we have more, variation? Why we take more time that? So I can further do IVA analysis on that also, okay? So this is just a small case study on that. We'll not. Okay, so if you have any question, I'll be happy to answer, and then otherwise I'll go to the next phase of. Okay, so can I go ahead to the next phase now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now, so we have understood now how to funnel this. We have many causes, 30 to 40. We have understood how to take it to the probable causes 10 to 15. But now the main idea is, how do we validate all these causes? How do we say machine is a cause or machine is not a cause? Or how do we say, material is a cause or material is not a cause, or a particular pump is a cause or not a cause? How do you prove this? You have to prove this with some statistical analysis. And that is what we are going to discuss in this phase. Okay. So here I am going to explain you about something called sampling distribution. We have point estimate versus interval estimate, and we have something called hypothesis testing. Okay, we will also do this, continue this chapter in post lunch session also. Okay, so first of all, let us understand the sampling distribution. Okay, now you all know what is the meaning of distribution. When you arrange the data, okay, according to its frequency, especially the variable data, or continuous data, it tends to form a shape. And that shape is called distribution. So if I have a population, I have a large number of data, it will have some pattern. So my shape can be like this, my shape can be like this, or my shape can be like this. Okay, I can have different kind of distributions. Okay, in statistics there are many distributions. If you go on the in the Minitab, you'll see a lot of distributions. Okay, now I don't know whether this is covered or not, but I want to confirm. Are you aware about center limit theorem? Are you all aware about center limit theorem? Was that covered in your major phase?
Not covered, sir.
No, sir.
Okay, so I think this is very important to understand. So what I will do is, I will just tell you about this. What is center limit theorem? Center limit theorem says, irrespective of your original distribution, let's say my population distribution is not normal distribution. It is Weibull distribution, or it is exponential distribution, or it is uniform distribution. Irrespective of my original distribution, when I collect the samples from the populations, and if I plot a chart on the mean of the samples, it always follows normal distribution. Irrespective of the original distribution, when you take the samples and plot the chart on the mean of the samples, it tends to follow normal distribution. So it is difficult to understand for you, for example, but let me just show this with practical, okay? And that is very important before we understand the hypothesis testing, okay? So I'll just share my other laptop. I'll share from other laptop where I have Minitab. If you have Minitab, you can also use this. Okay, you can also do this with me. Okay. So I'll just share my screen now. From other laptop. In most of the statistical analysis, we assume something called normality. We assume the data is following normal. Why we assume this? What is the logic that we have? The logic is this. For example, if I go to Minitab, let's say I generate a random data. I'm generating a random data from a uniform distribution. Let's say I am generating 1000 rows of random data. I'll store this in column C1. Okay. And let me have this values lower and values. That's okay. Let me keep it like this only. I have generated this data. Now you see in the C1 column, I have a uniform distribution. Now you know uniform distribution is very flat. So if I go to stat, if I create this, I have data, generated data just now only. This is a random data. If I plot a chart of this data, you will see it is having, it will have usually a flat distribution. You can see here, this is a flat distribution. Why? Because I have generated the data from a uniform distribution. Okay. Now what I will do is, I will do a sampling from this data. So you see I have 1000 data points. I have already generated in Minitab 1000 data points randomly. Okay. And this is no selection, Minitab has randomly generated from a uniform population. And as we all know, uniform population is not a normal distribution. You can also see the p-value is less than 0.05. Now I will do a sampling from this, okay? So let's say I generate now sample of
100 datas from all of this. I'll do the same thing, and I'm creating a sample from this 1,000 data points, two different columns actually. Okay. So I'm taking a sample. I'm taking a sample from this population which is not having normal distribution. Let me collect these 10 samples. I have now these 10 samples. You can see now that in this I have 100 data points. Each sample is having 100 data. You can see here my first column has 1,000 data, and I have from that data I have collected some random samples. You can see here now. Okay, so this is 100 data points. So what I will do now, I will create a mean of this data points. Okay, so I will collect the mean. So I'll say go to raw statistics. I'll calculate the mean of this raw C2, C10. So I have 9, and I'll store this in C13. So this is the mean of all this data. Now. So you are you able to understand what I have done? What I have done is I have basically I have separated the data. I have taken the samples and I have taken the mean of the samples. Now let's see what distribution it can follow. So I'll just go to basic statistics, go to graphical summary. Now I'll plot chart on this mean. Do you see now what distribution it is following? This is following a normal distribution. So this is called center limit theorem. That means my original data was not normal. It was uniform distribution. But what I have done is I have taken the samples from the population and I have calculated the mean. When I plot the chart of the mean, irrespective of the original population distribution, my sample mean follows a normal distribution. Are you able to understand this concept? Yes or no?
Sir, I have a doubt. Uniform distribution means that same set of data we are taking. Sir, uniform distribution means?
Okay, just a moment. I think you are speaking, but I'm not able to listen. Yeah, sorry, I was. Not able to listen to you. Yeah, please.
That uniform distribution data means that same set of data we are collecting. Am I correct?
Yeah. Uniform distribution means my outcome is not infinite. My outcome is finite. If I throw so that is like it's a uniform. It's a flat distribution actually, basically.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Correct. I can take the same any data. I can even take a sample from exponential distribution. I can take sample from that exponential distribution also. If I can, I can do the same thing with any. I mean, I've just shown you example of uniform distribution. You can take any particular distribution. If you take the samples, if you take the mean, you plot a chart, it will follow normal distribution. That's the beauty of the center limit theorem. So what we do is, we assume that the data is following a normal distribution. Okay, so that is one very fundamental this thing actually. Now with this concept, we have to go ahead actually, because that is very fundamental concept. So you have to understand this. And yeah, So that is something is very fundamental before I explain you about this, you know, the hypothesis testing and all this concept. Anybody has any doubt in this, further doubt?
You may ask the question if you are having any doubt. I think no, sir.
No, very good. So what I will do now, I will explain you about the concept of, I'll just stop sharing. Sorry for this because I have to use two laptops. Because I have one.
Yeah, so now what we will do is, we'll go ahead in this presentation and I will show you how we can understand this further. Statistics is very interesting subject. Once you start using it, you will fall in love with it. So yeah. So let's go ahead now. So let us understand now the sampling distribution. So now you know what is sampling distribution. Sampling distribution always follows a normal distribution. Actually, the sampling distribution is also called sometimes T distribution, but T distribution over a period of time also becomes normal actually. Okay, student T distribution. So let us first understand this concept. So I have the sample. I have the sample of Shruti, is my voice audible now? Because I'm just changing the laptop, so confirming.
Yes, sir. Properly.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Audible.
Yeah. So I have this data of diameter of a particular, shaft or something like that. Let's say, for example, and the requirement is that the specification is that it should be less than 110, for example. Okay. So how many okay? How many not okay? I have this data also. Okay. So usually, what happens in statistics? We make inferences. Inferences means we have two branches in statistics. One is called descriptive statistics, where we describe and understand the data. And the other is called inferential statistics, which means we may take the sample, make the inference about the population. You take the sample and you make the inference. That, and that is a major application of statistics, where you take the samples and make the inference about the, about the population. So usually we make the inferences for two or three parameters of the, in the population. Usually in Six Sigma, we are interested mainly in the mean, the standard deviation, and the proportion. So proportion is how many okay, how many not okay kind of a thing. So for that, in sample, I estimate X bar, which is for sample. I estimate standard deviation, or I estimate the P bar. That is called my for the sample proportion. Okay. So these are just a symbol which I use actually. And usually what happens in the statistics is we use a point estimate. So point estimate means I calculate the sample, I take the sample. If my sample mean is this, I assume that my population mean is also that. But that is not correct, because if you take the next sample, it will have another, I would say value. Okay, another mean. So which mean is correct then? So that's called point estimate. I'll explain you that later on. So usually we do either mean, standard deviation, and proportion. These are the three things that we are estimating. Okay. Now, if I take the next sample, let's say I have taken 15 samples here, and my mean was 111. If I take another 15 sample, replicating the same things, and another sample, is it going to be the same mean? No. So the mean will be different. Okay. You see, each sample I have taken and the each sample mean is different actually. Now, essentially, my sample also will have a distribution, and this is my mean of the sample. This is the next sample and its distribution, and it is its mean. Okay. Now, all the means are different. How do I collect which mean is correct now? That's a confusion actually. Okay. So what we do is we have in statistics, we have a method to estimate. That is called interval estimate. Okay, rather than estimating the point, rather than saying that my average is 113, I will say my average is somewhere between 111 to 113. That's a better estimate. Okay, So like that we will do. So this is the histogram I have created from this sample data. Okay, so this is for the same data I have created the histogram. As you can see, the mean is varying now for all the samples. So we calculate something called standard error of the mean. You will see this in Minitab a lot. Minitab, when you do the descriptive statistics, it will give you standard error of mean. Now here we call it standard error, but actually it is not standard error. Actually, it is actually standard deviation of sampling distribution. Standard deviation of sampling distribution is called standard error. The name is standard error. Okay, why we call it error also? Because each mean is having different, so we call it some error. Okay, so that's why it's the named as standard error, but actually it is a standard deviation of the sampling distribution. And what is the formula that we use? The formula is very simple. Standard error of mean is very simple. It's a sigma over square root of n. Okay, so if you see in that previous case, my standard deviation was 4, my sample size was 15. So my standard error of mean can be calculated as 1.03. Okay, so this is a simple calculation. Okay. Now, if you all know that Z-score table, if you have, you know, we say mu plus or minus one standard deviation, mu plus or minus two standard deviation, and mu plus or minus three standard deviation. Now here, the standard deviation I will replace by standard error of mean. So standard error of mean, the symbol is sigma, or you know, sub x bar. This is the symbol. So if I just want to know how much it is varying, can you tell me answer of this question? Mu plus or minus three standard deviation. What is the area under the curve in distribution? Anybody?
Sir, maybe 99.73.
Yes. When in any distribution, your in normal distribution, your mu plus or minus three standard deviation is 99.73% of area. Okay. Your mu plus or minus two standard deviation is, you know, it is 95% of area. And your mu plus or minus one standard deviation in case of normal distribution is 68% area approximately. It is also known as 68-95-99 rule. So this you have to remember actually. Okay. Now, so what I have done here is I have just graphically shown you over here in this from this previous example. From this example, we are now from this, sorry, this data, we have taken several samples. Each sample is having different mean. So how do I, what do I do actually? So what we do is we calculated. So this is my average, which is 113. I have put here, if my sample size is 15, my standard error or standard deviation is 1.03. If I take more samples, what will happen to the standard error? It will decrease. Why? Because it is sigma over square root of n. As I increase this denominator, my overall value will decrease. Okay. If I sample size of 400, then what will be my standard error of the mean? It is only going to be 0.2. Now here, if you see, this is also 113. This is also 113. If I add one standard deviation, this is going to the one standard deviation means 113 minus this value. Okay, this value. And here I have put 113 plus this value, standard error. And here I have, hello. So this is plus one standard deviation, this is plus two standard deviation, plus three standard deviation. So plus three means I have multiplied this with 113. And then I have added this, multiplied 1.03 with three, and then I have put this. So I got this value. Okay, now you see as my sample size is increasing, this is what I am getting actually. This is my getting. On one scale, if I put this on a scale actually here, you see my when my sample size was 15, my range is this. When my sample size is 100, my standard error of mean plus or minus three standard deviation is this range. My sample size is 400. My as I increase my sample size, my estimation accuracy is increasing. Okay, now so that is what is called, this is the same thing is shown here with graphics actually, that as I increase my sample size, my accuracy or my width of the distribution narrows down. So this blue one is 400, okay, sample size 400, it's narrow. When my sample size is less, my estimation accuracy can be it can vary. So what I have done is, we have this standard deviation was 4, our square root of n was 15. What happens if I increase my, and I will get the standard error of the mean. Okay, so this is the standard error. If I increase this sample by 16, 17, if I keep on increasing this, I will get different standard error value. So what I have done is, in this graph, I have put all the standard error values at a different sample size. You can see this sample size. Now, looking at this chart, what do you understand? This is my sample size is 15, my standard error is this. What is happening to my error over a period of time as I keep on increasing my sample size? What is your answer to this graph? Is standard error decreasing proportionately with sample size, or it is not that?
It is proportionate with respect to few early samples.
Yes, and then it almost flattens down. Of course, it will not be exactly flat, but what does it make a difference if I take 215 samples or I take 315? Now, this, if you see the difference is very less in terms of error. Are you able to understand this? Okay, but if I take 15 samples and if I take 55 samples, there is a huge difference, okay, of error. So this error is very important. So as my sample size increases, my error decreases. But it is not that more sample is good, because over a period of time, the error flattens. Estimation error flattens down because we are estimating with standard error. Okay. So in this case, what we do is we select the right sample size. In statistics, there is also a mechanism. Even in Minitab also, there is a mechanism to identify the sample size. So what we will do, if somebody is saying, is it because of machine? We'll take a sample and we'll verify. Now, how much sample we will take? We can use the sampling technique, actually, okay? And sample size. It's not that I have to take large number of samples. I can take small number of samples and still I can determine, okay? So this is what we are going to understand in the next chapter. So before we leave, most of us are doing point estimate. Most of us are doing point estimate means I will take the sample, and whatever is the mean of the sample, I'll say that is a sample mean of the population. That is a wrong method. Point estimate is wrong, because you take the next sample, it is not going to be the same answer. For example, let's say we have around 100 participants in this training program. If I take a sample of 10 people, and if I measure the height, and let's say my average height is coming to 168 centimeter, can I say the all the 100 participants height, average height is 160 centimeter? Yes or no? Is it accurate answer?
No, sir.
Why it is not? Because we are saying a point estimate. But what happens if I take another 10 samples? Maybe the average height is 169 centimeter. Then what is the population mean? I'm confused now. If I take another sample, my this thing is 170 centimeter. So which out of this is a real population mean then of the 100 participants? So we cannot estimate like that. We cannot say whatever sample I have collected, that is the mean of my population. So what we do is interval estimate. Okay. So let me just take, this is the last slide before we depart, actually, for before lunch. Can you estimate how many gumballs are there in this jar? And you have two or three options. So one option is you can say exact numbers. The other option is you can tell me the range. Okay. So which one is, what is your answer to this? Just any random number, if anybody can say how many gumballs are there probably in this jar, how do you estimate? You want to say point or you want to say interval?
Interval, sir. Range. Range. Between so and so.
Between so and so. So you can say like, can you give me some random number? I'm approximate. I mean, there's nothing to do with this actual number.
100
to 200. Anybody else? Somebody has given 2000 to
200 to 250, sir.
Okay. We have very good answers now. So somebody is saying 75 to 200. Okay. Now, and somebody is saying 2000 to 250. Okay, now you see, what is 300 to 350. Okay. Can you understand now what is happening here is, who can be most probably right in this case? The one who is giving higher range is going to be right because he is giving broad range. And the one who is giving narrow range is saying 300 to 350. Only 50 numbers are different. Now here it is 125 number gap, and here it is only 50 number gap. So this answer, in this the error chances of giving my decision wrong is higher here, but less here. But at the same time, I am using more range, you know. So because you are, I can say 0 to 1000, and everything is covered then. So accuracy of estimation depends. I can always estimate. I can always use these numbers rather than saying that it is 350 or 355. It is always better to estimate the population, especially it is a continuous data, to always better to give range rather than a particular exact answer. But now the question is, how do I decide the range? How do I decide the range? That is what we are going to discuss in the post-lunch session. A very interesting topic. I mean, you will love it actually. What is the power of statistics? You will know in this post-lunch session. We'll discuss how can you estimate the intervals, okay? And based on the intervals, how can we reject anybody's claim? How can we accept anybody's claim in hypothesis testing? Okay, with this note, I think I'm 2 minutes more to my original presentation. So if anybody has any question till now, we can discuss or we will meet after post lunch.
Participants, you may ask the questions. I think there is no question. Sir, thank you very much for this wonderful session.
Okay, very good. Thank you. So we meet at 2:30, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And my request is they can keep the Minitab ready if they have, so we can do some practice if they want it, right? If they have Minitab, yeah.
Yes, sir. Majority of the participants are having, and they are having also all the data.
Okay, then we will do some exercise on it. Okay, good. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Welcome.
All the participants are requested to join the next session on time at 2:30. Thank you very much.